Hello everyone, welcome to my YouTube channel. This video is about neonatology and I will discuss some important high yield facts in form of simple questions and answers. Question number 1. How long has meconium been present in amniotic fluid if an infant has evidence of meconium staining? And the answer is, gross staining of the infant is a surface phenomena that is proportional to the length of exposure and meconium concentration. With heavy meconium, staining of the umbilical cord begins in as little as 15 minutes, while with light meconium, it occurs after 1 hour. Yellow staining of the newborn's toenail requires about 4 to 6 hours, while staining of the vernix gaseosa takes about 12 to 14 hours. Now, what are increased risk of twin pregnancies? These include premature delivery, intrauterine growth restriction including discordant growth, increased perinatal mortality especially for premature, monozygotic and discordant twins, spontaneous abortion, birth asphyxia, fetal malposition, placental anomalies including abruptio placenta and placenta previa, and polyhydramnios. Question 3. What are clinical consequences for fetus from maternal preeclampsia? These include intrauterine growth restriction, preterm birth, hypoglycemia, neutropenia, and thrombocytopenia. Number 4. Which conditions are associated with intra-abdominal calcification? Meconium peritonitis and intra-abdominal tumors are most common disorders associated with intra-abdominal calcification in the neonate. Calcification of the meconium peritonitis are streaky or plague-like and occur over abdominal surface of diaphragm or along the flanks. Intra-abdominal calcification have also been observed in infants with adrenal hemorrhage and congenital infections. What features on physical examination suggest a specific cause of thrombocytopenia? Blueberry muffin rash indicate torch infection, that is toxoplasmosis, rubella, cytomegalovirus or herpes virus. Absence of radii indicates thrombocytopenia absent radii syndrome. Palpable flank mass and hematuria indicate renal vein thrombosis. Hemangioma, especially large and with Brui, indicate Kaeser-Beck-Merritt syndrome. Abnormal thumbs indicate Fanconi anemia, but thrombocytopenia is less likely in newborns. Now, markedly dysmorphic features indicate chromosomal anomalies, especially trisomy 13 or 18. Now, when do prothrombin time and partial thromboplastin time normalize to adult values in an infant? Prothrombin time reaches adult values at about 1 week of age, whereas partial thromboplastin time does not attain adult values until 2 to 9 months of age. Now, question number 7. How is disseminated intravascular coagulation, that is DIC, diagnosed in the neonate? Laboratory findings of DIC include evidence of RBC fragmentation on peripheral smear, elevation of prothrombin time, partial thromboplastin time and thrombin time, thrombocytopenia and decreased level of factor 5, 8 and fibrinogen, and in some cases presence of fibrin split products. Now, is there a role for probiotics in prevention of necrotizing enterocolitis? Probiotics are non-pathogenic bacteria that promote health when allowed to multiply within the gastrointestinal tract. In human breast milk, they consist primarily of lactobacillus and bifidobacterium species. Now, a systemic review of multiple studies have revealed that probiotics cause a reduction in the risk for necrotizing enterocolitis, especially in infants more than 1 kg. Now, what are the clinical manifestations of polycythemia in a neonate? Most common signs due to polycythemia include lethargy, hypotonia, tremors, and irritability. In severe cases, seizures can occur. Hypoglycemia is also common. Other organ systems can be affected, including GIT, in which there may be vomiting, distension, or neck. In kidneys, there may be renal vein thrombosis and acute renal failure, and cardiopulmonary system involvement leading to respiratory distress, pulmonary hypertension, and congestive cardiac failure. However, infants with polycythemia are often asymptomatic. Now, what is the relationship between neonatal hyperbilirubinemia and urinary tract infection? Unexplained jaundice developing between 10 and 60 days of age can be associated with a UTI in infants. Typical patient is afebrile with hepatomegaly and minimal systemic symptoms. Hyperbilirubinemia is usually conjugated and liver transaminases may be normal or mildly elevated. Now, treatment of UTI usually results in reversal of liver dysfunction, which is believed to be due to the endotoxin produced by the E. coli. Now, question number 11. Why is it not always possible to auscultate a murmur in an infant with a ventricular septal defect on first day of life? Murmurs are generated by high velocity or highly turbulent blood flow. Now, pulmonary artery pressure decreases dramatically over first several days of life, leading to a larger systemic to pulmonary pressure gradient. As the pressure gradient increases, blood flow across the ventricular septal defect increases in velocity and murmur become more prominent. Now, what features constitute fetal biophysical profile? Biophysical profile is a scoring system that assess fetal well-being before birth. 5 variables are used: fetal breathing movements, gross body movements, fetal tone, reactive fetal heart rate, and qualitative amniotic fluid volume. Now, normal result is equal to 2 points per variable for a possible total of 10 points. Now, what is the first bone in human fetus to ossify? And the answer is clavicle. In long bones, process of ossification occur in primary centers of ossification in diaphysis during the embryonic period of the fetal development. Although femur are first long bones to show traces of ossification, clavicles, which develop initially by intramembranous ossification, begin to ossify before any other bones in the body. Now, when do premature infants catch up on growth charts? Most catch-up growth take place during first 2 years of life, with maximal growth rate occurring between 36 and 40 weeks after conception. Now, little catch-up growth occur after chronologic age of 3 years, and about 15% of infant born prematurely remain below normal weight at 3 years of age. Now, what are major risk factors for nosocomial sepsis? These include prematurity, use of parenteral alimentation and central lines, intravenous fat emulsion, H2 blockers, steroids, prolonged duration of mechanical ventilation, overcrowding, and heavy staff workloads. Now, in what settings should inborn errors of metabolism be suspected? These include onset of symptoms that correlate with dietary changes, loss or leveling of developmental milestones, lethargy, patient with strong food preferences or aversion, parental consanguinity, unexplained sibling death, mental retardation or seizures, unexplained failure to thrive, vomiting or poor feeding, unusual odor, hair abnormalities, especially alopecia, microcephaly or macrocephaly, abnormalities of muscle tone, organomegaly, coarsened facial features, thick skin, and limited joint mobility. Now, what key urine odors are associated with inborn error of metabolism? Cabbage odor is present in type 1 tyrosinemia, cat urine in carboxylase deficiency, maple syrup in maple syrup urine disease, mousy or musty odor is present in phenylketonuria, and sweaty feet or cheesy smell is present in isovaleric acidemia and type 2 glutaric aciduria. What features on physical examination suggest etiology of hypoglycemia? Macrosomia indicate infant of diabetic mother, congenital hyperinsulinism or Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome. Midline defects indicate congenital pituitary deficiency. Micropenis is present in case of congenital hypopituitarism. Hepatomegaly indicate glycogen storage disease and fatty acid oxidation defects. And small for gestational age is the risk for both hypoglycemia and polycythemia. How do human foremilk and hind milk differ? Caloric density of human milk increases in a non-linear fashion while the infant is breastfeeding. Hind milk, which is produced at the end of the feeding, can have a fat content that is 50% higher than the foremilk. Now, in preterm infants with poor weight gain, hind milk may offer a nutritional advantage. Now, what are physiological effects of positive end expiratory pressure in mechanical ventilation? Now, positive end expiratory pressure can prevent alveolar collapse, maintaining lung volume at end expiration and improve ventilation perfusion mismatch. However, an increase in PEEP may decrease tidal volume and impede carbon dioxide elimination. Elevation in PEEP to non-physiologic values may decrease lung compliance, impair venous return, decrease cardiac output, and reduce tissue oxygen delivery. Thanks for watching this video. Please like, share, comment, and subscribe to my YouTube channel.